Well, thank you everybody for coming to the West Linn Historical Society's author series. Thank you for spending part of your Sunday afternoon with us. I'm Roger Shepherd. I'm president of the Historical Society. If you've heard me talk before, I hope I don't sound like a broken record, but I usually always start out saying, just because we don't have a museum in West Linn doesn't mean we don't have a lot of history, a lot of very interesting history. The West Linn Historical Society has an initiative called History Without Walls. So instead of you coming to a museum to experience history, we bring history out to the community. And we've just been going through setting our 2018 goals for the year. And we've got a very ambitious year planned. In addition to our signature event, the Living History Tour in September, we're also bringing back our Voices Without Walls in May. We're doing the old time radio show again in, what did we decide, April, I think, March. We're doing a old time fashion show in tea in February. We're again doing something called History is Child's Play, part of the library summer reading program, where the kids come and experience pioneer life and that type of thing. 2018 is the 175th anniversary of the beginning of the Oregon Trail, so we're going to help celebrate that by probably going down the Old Time Fair parade with a covered wagon maybe and dressed as pioneers. We'll probably also do something at the Old Time Fair along that line. So we've got a very ambitious year. Another example of History Without Walls is our author series, where we invite authors to come talk that have written something about history in the area. And we're very honored today to have Dede Montgomery, who is one of our board of stewards, kind of an advisory board to the Historical Society. She started this author series, and this is the fourth or fifth in the series. She's also starting a program that's going to be tied with our annual meeting in January. It's an Ignite series. We're very excited about it. I can't explain it very well, but it's like a lightning talk where you have like 5 minutes to talk and the slides change every 20 seconds or something. So look for that in mid-January. That's going to be part of our annual meeting. But I am... have a lot of admiration for Dede. I've tried to do some writing before, but I'm envious of Dede and the fact that she's actually finished something. She's finished her book, and I've started reading it, haven't completed it yet, but I love it. And so with that, I'm going to introduce you to Dede Montgomery.
Thank you, Dede Roger. Montgomery. Thanks. Thank you all for being here. You know, I had my book launch and I was just so touched. I had all these friends show up. And now I'm doing my reading at the library and I'm having all these friends show up. And it's really wonderful. So thank you for being here. You know, I feel like I thank the Historical Society for sponsoring. And I really thank the library. And I was a library kid. The library, whether it's here, my home now, or whether growing up it was Multnomah County Central towards the end of my growing up, or whether it was LeGrand Carnegie for a while, libraries have been probably one of my most favorite places, if not. I was the kind of kid that read all the time. In fact, battles with my father were because I would sneak books under the dinner table. And we would have a conversation about why newspapers were allowed, but not books. And so in saying that, I'm really excited to talk about this book. And I want to just acknowledge a couple of you have started the book. So you may know the character Pat in the book is my oldest brother, and he is sitting in the back. He's not allowed to talk until the very end. I also have two friends who were my book reviewers, Karen Bonoff and Kermit McCarthy. So that's very fun to have you both here also, and thank the rest of you. And so this book, when I was 18 and a freshman at the University of Montana, I didn't know what I wanted to be. I kind of thought I'd be a social worker. I knew I loved to write. My father was a writer. My grandfather was a writer. You'll hear about that. My great-great-grandfather was known for a pretty well-known bookstore. But I did love to write, and so I took a mishmash of classes, including I took a creative writing class. And it was taught by William Kittredge. If any of you know him as an author, he grew up in Southern Oregon. He's written wonderful cowboy stories and a beautiful memoir that's quite old. But if you're looking for a book about place, that it is. But in this class, I was like, I'm a good writer. This is cool. I'm going to write. And I'm 18. And where my heart took me was to the Willamette River. And I wrote my first short story about the Willamette River. And it was really bad. And I was sad I wasn't the one pointed out to have the best book or the best story. But what I knew at the time was writing is really hard. It takes a lot of patience. And what I really felt was I didn't have a story. I didn't know what to write about other than the fact that I just had this deep love of the Willamette River and our native valley. And so when my father died, and this is my father, Dick Montgomery, and I should say this is Patrick, and this is me, and this is my brother Andrew, in the 60s on the Willamette River, in the Dede. When my dad died in July of 2014, I was sad. I was devastated. And although I knew he'd had a really long, very good life, what really came at me were all the stories he knew and told. He was a writer. He was an amazing storyteller. And I felt this sense of, I've got to capture it. I've got to capture those stories. And I'm very lucky because of some of our family members, some of our history is, in fact, nicely captured and shared and protected through several of our really historical associations in the state. But what I didn't have were some of these stories that went back to the heart of what I could remember and beyond. And so I started writing. And what I'd like to start, I'm going to do three readings. Two are pretty, very short, like a paragraph to start. But to me, this is really, this first paragraph here, my chapter 4 summer, for me is the epitome of what I feel about the Willamette in the Willamette River. So chapter 4, summer. Summer is true river time. Lazy summer emanates nature's special recipe, a potpourri of carp and cottonwood that transports any grown-up river kid back to childhood on the rivers of the Willamette Valley. After cottonwoods cover banks and nearby roads with white fluffy fibers, mowers and tractors hew lawns and till soil. The milky fibers drop from overhanging limbs into the Willamette, creating a strangely enticing scum. The smell of river summer doesn't fully ripen until late June. It rises mildly on a morning, simmering until late afternoon as the banks absorb the sun's warmth, and then, finally, release the ultimate summer river smell, a fishy blend spiked with decomposing cottonwood fibers and soon-to-burst blackberry blossoms. And to me, that is part of the Willamette. The Willamette has every season, and that's my thought on summer. And what I would say with all of the changes, the good and the bad, the challenges in land and zoning and everything else that we face, that view and that feel of the Willamette still exists in those places where you can get down to the river. And so in my book, I have captured, I probably have 40 or 50 images in this book. And this is, of course, does belong within that chapter of summer, as does this one. Now, I didn't normally hold hands with my brother.
Where is this?
This is our dock. Okay, so thank you, Kelly. So let me step back. So I grew up on the banks of the Willamette in Wilsonville. I was a Wilsonville kid in the 60s and early 70s. I wasn't born there, but when I was three, my dad and mom decided to build a house in Wilsonville on a street called Tony Montgomery Way. And Tony, I did used to babysit him. He used to live there. And so this picture is our dock down below. And I would tell you that I didn't commonly hold hands with my brother. But what I love about this picture is it reminds me of what else was happening in that time period. So I believe that being a kid of the 60s and into the 70s, Tom McCall was really, and what happened with Tom McCall and the attempt to protect Oregon was a really big part of my life and maybe many of yours. And this picture was 1969, and it was an ad. My dad took this photo, and he wasn't necessarily a talented photographer, but he did write copy. And at the time, he was doing advertising for the United Sewerage Agency. And so we got to look like we were so concerned about the effluent that did float up down the Willamette River from the sewage more in the Tualatin, but a lot of the pulp and paper mills at the time. But that would be another photo. You can read more about that. So I wrote about the river, and as I wrote, when I really started this, I thought it's going to be about Dad. And it's going to be about my great-greats and my great-great-greats, and that's who needs to be in this story. And what most good writers will tell you, way more experienced than me, is you have to write about yourself. Maybe, because you know it. You know your story, and you know your perceptions and memories of that story. And so as I continued to write, it became a lot more about me and my dad. And so what I'd like to do is share another passage. I would tell you that one of the chapters I had an awful lot of fun writing was this third chapter called Baseball. And I'm just going to get you right into the middle of it and read maybe a page. This is my father, Dick Montgomery. He was born in 1930. He's a teen. Some of you have read this book. Anybody have any idea other than my brother or my mother tell you where you think this could be? But that's a hard question. It could be a ball field anywhere, right? This is Wallace Park, which is next to Chapman Elementary School, which is where my dad grew up in Northwest Portland. And he loved baseball. I think he probably loved baseball more than any sport, at least until later in life. And he was one of those kids when he was younger that worked really hard to try to get a scorekeeping job at the Vaughn, the Beaver Stadium, the Lucky Beaver Stadium, which was really a popular place in the 30s and beyond, the 1930s. So I'd like to read to you a page about baseball. One spring day, perhaps a bit like the first day of professional spring training, I cajoled Mike into playing catch with me in the yard, underneath our enormous branching maple tree. This is outside our house in Wilsonville. Dad was in his bathroom, shaving with the window wide open, catching the fresh morning air. He looked out to see us tossing the baseball and impulsively yelled the phrase he would repeat in jest for another 7 decades. A few of you knew my father, and if you remember much about him, you remember he had these lines he liked, and he would repeat them. And it was always fun. A few of them got old. But this was a line that he liked to say a lot. Dede, no hardball. Now, honestly, how could he expect the only daughter of 5 children to respond? Dad, I yelled, that's not fair. What about Mike? Mike looked at me. We don't have a picture of the baseball incident. I'm sorry about that. Mike looked at me a bit confused. What did he have to do with this conversation? "You're a male chauvinist," I said to Dad. I knew better than to add pig, as Jane Fonda had popularized. I was starting to look for ways to question Dad. On this morning, Dad looked back at me, also a bit confused, half his face covered with shaving cream. "Mike is younger than me." "It isn't fair," I repeated. "What was the problem exactly?" I wondered. Silence still from Dad. He struggled with change. Everything seemed to be happening so fast. But he was smart. "Both of you," he caught on. "You are both too young to play with a hardball." Keep in mind, my brother was probably playing Little League at that time, but use the softball. And he went back to his shaving. Mike looked at me. "Thanks a lot," he mouthed. The rule lasted about a day, and quickly Mike and I returned, without approval, to our usual game of catch. But for me, it was a lesson. A lesson I learned I would be forced to repeat again and again. I think I might read just a tiny bit more of this section. And I'll get back to that again and again thing in a minute. Although I enjoyed playing catch with my siblings, when they weren't around or when we got tired of each other, I spent hours in front of the pitchback rebound net. Anybody played with those? My older brothers had received as a Christmas gift, perfecting my pitches, actually perfecting my form. I don't think my accuracy was much to shout about, but I had two sharp-looking pitches, a stretch and a windup. I really thought the windup was more dramatic, dropping my right leg back, right hand with a baseball resting on the back of my right hip as I looked seriously to first the left and then the right at the imaginary base runners. I practiced throwing pitches over and over. But I have to be honest, what I really coveted were the white flannel uniforms the boys who played Little League were assigned when they joined their teams. I was the most frequent loiterer at Mike's baseball practices, and finally one season, the coach asked me if I'd run bases. I was overjoyed to be able to wear a batter's helmet. I excitedly ran the bases outfitted in my school clothes, a skirt, blouse, and scuffed black buckled Oxfords. As tired as I got, I was happy to keep trying to round those turns. Girls were not yet allowed to wear pants at Wilsonville Elementary. Although it seemed so unfair when I learned that my Portland girl cousins were allowed to wear them every day if they wished. After a few times base running, I knocked the barely half-inch heel right off my right brown leather shoe, and I had to glue it back on before I could wear it to school again. It took a while, but finally when I was 11, our family's teenage friend Jeff offered to let me play on the Little League team he was coaching that summer. I didn't think much at first about being the only girl, although it was only 1972, and Tatum O'Neill and the Bad News Bears hadn't yet invited girls to imagine joining the ranks of boys' baseball, nor had the federal Little League charter yet been changed to allow girls to play. Few girls were breaking into Oregon Little League yet, but I was mostly excited about finally being able to wear the flannels of Little League. And you can read more about how that Little League season went for me. But really, it's a story about my dad, because as some of you who have read the book or know our family story, I became to move into a time in my teens where my relationship was really challenged with my father. And what I love about my book, and what I didn't want to write at first, was about how there were really bad things with me and my dad, and yet I got to spend the last 35 years with him with a most spectacular relationship. And so I appreciate the fact that although my dad was an alcoholic, he came to terms with that at 50 and knew what he needed to do about it. But when I think back to my years, I was a real athlete. I played college volleyball, and my dad loved that. But at the time, I didn't. I knew he was there. I was a hard time for us. And so we got to tease about it later. And that's why, in part, that hardball conversation is so fun for me now, and it was fun for him for a lot of years. So I've talked a lot about my personal life, my life with my dad, but as you can see, I haven't really talked a lot about the history piece. And if you've looked at the back cover of my book, I say I weave seven generations of an Oregon family into this book, which I do, and which I would say was both, for me, the most challenging part of writing this book and the most fun. And I'm going to read an example for you in a minute about how I did that in one of my chapters. But let's look at a couple people. Who am I talking about? This is a woman named Chloe Clark, or later to be Chloe Clark Willson. She was my great-great-great-grandmother. And if those of you that know Elizabeth Rokia, that would be her great-great-grandmother. She came around the Horn in 1837. That's way before the trail started bringing people. And she came around with, who do you think? The Jason Lee missionaries. So she was a 21-year-old Methodist who said, I know what I need to do. I need to bring Christianity. I need to help. I take a deep breath there. The American Indians, or what they might have called the natives or the Indians. And so I'm taking a deep breath, because in this talking about history, we all look through history and our own version of history with a different lens. And so it was interesting for me to do that in writing about her. And I would tell you, if you noticed any of the albums out front, my mother, Patty, I thank her, because in the 1990s, she went back into my dad's history and pulled a lot of it together. A lot of it that has been saved in other places that I'll refer to. And you'll notice it was really important to me to source my book, to source all the history parts. So if you get to chapters that have history, you can go back and see what sources I used if you ever wanted to look at them or learn more. So this is Chloe Clark later in her life. I don't know what year. It's the only photo I actually have of her. And so you learn about Chloe Clark in here. And I'm going to read from her journal and my interpretation of that in just a minute. And this is the man she married, my great-great-great-grandfather, William Willson. He came around 3 years. I think I just told her year wrong. She came around in 1840. And he came around in 1837. So I think I was off by 3 years when I said that. He came around a little earlier. She was with the great reinforcement with Jason Lee on the Lausanne. And he came around on a ship called the Diana. And he was a carpenter. He was brought out to build mission buildings that they were going to build. And he had been a whaler and a real kind of really interested in adventure. So he and Chloe met up at Nisqually. That was the first place she was posted. And they were married within 31 days. Although she didn't want to get married when she, you know, we have some great quotes about that before she moved out here. And then what I want to read to you is shortly after they left, let's not go there. Shortly after their time in Nisqually, they came to the Willamette Falls. And so I would tell you that probably my most favorite part, I don't know, I have several favorite chapters, but one of my favorite chapters is chapter 6, The Falls. Okay, so this is the first photo. I'll go back to the other. Sorry about that get you a little seasick. This is how I start The Falls. And what I like to tell you is that I grew up Patrick and I grew up with this print that was always above my parents' bed. And I don't know if you can see that print, but there is a white-headed guy in it on the left, and some early settlers also in it, and that is John McLaughlin. And I always thought that he was a relative for a long time, because my grandfather, Daddy Dick to me, or Richard G. Montgomery Sr., my dad's father, did write a book about John McLaughlin. He wrote three books, and he wrote one called The White-Headed Eagle. And so when I was really young, and that's me, and that's my mom, and my dad, and my brother Andrew again, Patrick is probably taking the picture, I'm thinking. You're playing around with photography. But I really did think he was family. Why else would we have this picture up there? But my youngest brother, Rick, thought it was God. I mean, I'm serious. He did, for the longest time. He thought that was a picture of God. So, just to kind of, let's go back for a minute. Let's actually get back to Chloe here. So, I start out the falls with that. And I also talk about a fun little story of our daughters and a little homework project they had at Cedar Oaks School that I'll let you read about, which was regarding John McLaughlin. But where I'm going to read to you is this. How different from today that June at Willamette Falls must have been. As cottonwoods even then sent out their pungent blasts of spring, absent was today's cacophony of noises. Engines puffing along Oregon City rail tracks, cars roaring along Interstate 205, jet skis in the river below. But oh, the falls, soon to be the end of the Oregon Trail. I admire the falls of today, not quite in their full glory, yet majestic still. I try to imagine how they looked in the mid-1800s. Here's a quote. As they break over huge rocks in a spume of white spray, and to see the fish, shining silver, jump up the waters is a sight that I wish I might share with my dear sister, wrote Chloe. Chloe began making shirts for the local American Indians, although so many had been lost through disease. 300 or so still gathered at the falls during the season of salmon, from January through August. Native Americans within the lower Columbia and throughout the Willamette Valley had suffered greatly from the cold sick, an especially deadly influenza outbreak between 1829 and 1832. Although the Falls tribes were not completely destroyed, the epidemics of the disease and others significantly impacted their numbers. The missionaries found they needed to go to the lodges to share their beliefs with the Native Americans. The alternative was to pay the Indians to come to the mission. Clearly, Native Americans weren't begging to learn about Christianity. William was gone a good deal as he traveled to the coast to build the Clatsop Mission near today's Astoria. Chloe wrote regrettably in letters and in her diary that she wasn't more useful or more holy. She was discouraged in her attempts to learn the Native American languages as she realized how each tribe spoke their own, and she could never keep up given the different tribes then surrounding the Willamette Valley. She was also discouraged by the nomadic life of the people during the 1 week she might have them in school, but knowing that the next week the same students might be 20 to 30 miles away. So she was the first teacher, the first white teacher in the Puget Sound area, and that would be on the Oregon Territory, because that's what she did up at Nisqually also. Chloe's optimism seeped away as the missionaries' Christian messages failed to make an impact among the Native people. Quote, and this is from her diary that is preserved online in longhand by Willamette University, and I do cite that. Our prospects for doing good in this land are very dark, she scribed. Rum is being sold here, and we fear very much harm will be done by ardent spirit, and the spirit of the Lord will not long inhabit the same body together. Chloe was afraid and looked to God to protect her from, quote, the dart of the arrow, the stab of the knife. She wrote, we know not when we lie down to sleep, but we may be waked by the war whoop. Send down thy spirit and let these tribes be gathered into thy fold. She prays, O thou who hast promised to be with thy servants to the end, be with them and give edge to thy truth and let it find its way even to the wildest savage's heart. O Lord, bless our enemies and make them thy friends. I recoil as I read a descriptor she routinely chooses. My blood, my inheritance, our past. And I think I'll stop reading there at that point. And so for me, as I wrote this book, there was a lot of, I guess you could say, introspection about this land that I love, the environment that I love. I don't always mean to be looking at you, David, when I say the environment that I love. And what's happened with some of it, and the change, and the forgiveness sometimes that we give ourselves or give family members, or maybe give others. And so I found that a very interesting kind of key line that goes through my storytelling. So that was Chloe. And Chloe and you can read all the details between them living in the falls and where they lived next, which was Salem. And Chloe was, in fact, the first teacher at what is today Willamette University, or what was then called the Oregon Institute. So after this kind of failed, what felt to them as a failure, and if some of you know the Jason Lee missionary history way better maybe than I do, and there's a bit about that in this book, but they moved on to Salem and had a land claim where today's Capitol and Willamette University are. So they're really thought of, and I use the term, I'm going to share it because I love it. Willamette University on their website says they were recognized as the first power couple in Salem. So I want to just introduce you, just with a little bit of time left, a couple of the other key characters that you've maybe heard of before or not, but you might like their stories. And so this gentleman in the middle, some of you may know, I'm looking at my notes so I can get the right years on here. This is J.K. Gill of the J.K. Gill Bookstore, and that would be my great-great-grandfather. And so he married Chloe and Chloe and thank you, Chloe and William's daughter, Frances. Okay, and this is him with five daughters. In let me get you a year. I think this is. Bear with me a second. This is the 1920s. That's all I know. He had a son also named Mark, but I just, they look so stern, don't they? And he was a fairly stern man, I understand. And he lived a pretty long life. So this is him in 1930. This is taken in Northwest Portland, where my father's grandparents lived. Some of you have read this part, but there's a house as you go above McClay Park on the bridge that goes over the gully, and there's a drinking fountain. And that is the house on the right that they lived in, that Elizabeth Rokia lived in. Some of you know Elizabeth. So this is my father, and he was born in 1930. And so I love this picture with my dad and his brother Bill, and I really don't know who the kid on the left is. Sorry about that. So he's a very old man. This is very close to when he died, in his 90s. This is a character in the book who's probably my father's favorite character, because for my dad, this brought back to him. I haven't really talked that much about my dad yet. My dad not only was a storyteller, but he knew more about maritime history than anybody, I would fathom to say. He worked it through writing. He loved it. He knew the Willamette. He knew the Columbia. And he loved to talk river tales and river stories, and not always agreeing with some of the last river happenings, that decisions that were made on, let's just say, the commercial opportunities within Portland and beyond. But this is J.K. Gill's brother, Sam Gill. And he was a steamship guy. He was an engineer for most of his life after getting laid off from an ironworker job. And this picture is in the late 1800s. And what's really cool about Sam Gill is he was a writer, too. So you can go to the, you'll see some quotes in here and some citations. And he had both a journal, and he wrote newspaper articles at the time that he talked about his journeying as a steamship engineer up and down our Willamette and Columbia. So I have some great steamship stories in here. My dad, who wrote his obituary, because that's what writers do, he cites him as giving him the love of the rivers. Other key characters in here, this gentleman on this side is my great-grandfather. His name was William Montgomery. His parents came over from Ireland. That's the Irish music side of me. And he married J.K. Gill's daughter because when he came out here, he started working at J.K. Gill's. And he decided to meet and marry the daughter of the owner. And so that would be my great-grandfather. And this is early opera, by the way, Portland's men's singing group for years and years. And I have a very significant chapter in my book is about music. That's called Heartstrings. And you'll learn, you know, even though my dad wasn't a musician, we were flooded with the love of music from both my parents. This is him as an older man. This is my great-grandfather, William Montgomery. And he is next to J.K. Gill's daughter, Georgia. And this, of course, is my father. And this is his brother. And that's Elizabeth Rokia's older sister, Anne. And that's on the corner, or rather on the steps of that house I was describing in Northwest Portland. Okay, so let's go down a generation, just introducing you to the characters. Step down one. This is my grandfather, Daddy Dick, I call him. I've mentioned him. He was the author of several books, including The White-Headed Eagle. He worked at J.K. Gill Company. He wanted to be a doctor, and then he decided, nah, I like books. And so I love this photo of an early J.K. Gill's. It was taken in the 1930s. No, 1934. He also did some radio he did book chats on the radio. And this is a 1934 picture. So as you kind of see, I really do try to weave throughout the different things I talk about, different stories from the different eras and the different generations. He married her. This is my grandmother, my namesake, Dorothy Harridan Montgomery. This is her picture the year she was a Rose Festival princess. And she looks older to me than that, but she was 17 or 18 in this picture in 1925. And she married a man a little bit older than her. So let's talk about my dad for a minute before, and I'll certainly take some pictures. So this is, I think this is my brother Michael's favorite picture of my dad. This is his kind of newspaper kind of picture. He was a short time, he was editor and publisher of the Le Grand Observer. Thus his year and a half or 2 years living outside of the Willamette Valley. And you'll learn more about why it happened and why it ended. And that was, I think my brother Patrick believes, that was probably some of the happiest couple years of his life, actually. He loved that job.
3 years.
3 years. 3 years for him, a year and a half for us. I talked about this era. This is my dad, mom, my brother Andrew. It's a high school basketball game, state championship or something crazy like that. But this is the era that I look back at and dad and I would talk about and think, oh, you know, I didn't really like you then, dad. And this is, of course, where my dad's favorite place to be. This is right near Wilsonville in our Dede on a picture in the late 60s. And he loved his boats, and he loved his river history. This was before my dad lived in West Linn for 3 years prior to his passing away, but this is before he left the little condo he lived in with my mom, and you can see all of his memorabilia about rivers and his job with the Port of Portland and so forth, and he loved that. He loved his little space where he'd go write. Out his world, his love, he would, you know, and you can read more about that, but he knew so much about the dry docks, about the shipyards. He knew all those stories. He wrote about them, and he loved it. He loved it. Even maybe some of the stuff we didn't love, he loved. And this is the final photo I wanted to show you, which is my dad's up top there. Anybody recognize this boat? Yeah, that's the Portland, right? That's the Portland steamer. You've probably noticed it, or maybe you haven't. It's the Oregon Maritime Museum. If you've never gone in, go in sometime. It's parked, it's moored right down on the waterfront in Portland. My dad was a president for a period of time when they refurbished it, basically. And we were lucky enough, Kelly was our videographer, we were lucky enough to have his memorial service on that boat, which was really cool. And I think I'm going to be doing a reading on the boat sometime, probably in 2018, which will be really cool. And so really, this is the stuff, you know. If you know, there's all the history, and I really, you know, I hope you enjoy learning maybe some things about Oregon Territory days that you didn't know. And I also hope that more than anything, you think about the stories that you have. You know, steamboats. I know David Hedges has some great steamboat stories through his family. And, you know, how do you share those? And they do change, right? Different people have different versions of the same story. Different writers write about different ways that we remember. And maybe that's okay. It's up to us to decide what stories we're going to hand down. But I think the power of story for us, for our friends, for our kids, for whoever it might be is really, really important. So that's my story. And thank you for listening.